The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition by a man who almost needs no introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway. A man of many names. He was, when I started watching him, he was All Night. Then he became the hashtag scumbag, and now he's just the infamous. It's Ian Ambrose. Welcome to the show.
Hello. How are we doing?
Not bad. I was a little silence there. This is an audio medium as well. But the video is just as good because, you know, gets to see our faces. The first question is always the same. It's the boring podcast question. Now we can actually get to asking decent stuff. But people need to know, how did you get into pro wrestling? What was the moment when you were watching that got you hooked on it?
I don't know, because like, I think I watched it when I was really, really young, but then I never kind of stayed with it. And then it was kind of around about, I'd say like 1999, summertime. I wasn't like watching anything, but like, I remember we didn't have Sky or nothing. So like, I didn't really have any access to it. And I remember being on holiday and there was an episode of Raw, and I was like on holiday in the Caribbean, and I was on the big TV. One day they had this like communal thing at the hotel we were at, and they had like a big TV, and it came on one day, and I just like was hooked. I can't remember what it was. I remember it was like, it must have been like Mankind, Undertaker, Kane, that kind of era, 98 maybe. And then like I kept staying in that room on that TV just waiting to see if it would come on again. And then about a year later I went around my mate's house and we were all playing like Gran Turismo at the time. We were all going around to play that at lunchtime. That's how old I am, at high school. And he had like a copy of Warzone out and he was playing it. And we were all just like, and he was like, oh, well, I'll finish my game. And then I was sitting watching and I was like, no, can we keep playing this? This is pretty cool. What is this? And then I kind of, from then on, I kind of sought out on the internet, the early days of the internet, I guess. WWF at the time, and then I just started buying VHS from like Woolworths when I had money. I would like save my lunch money, and then so that's kind of how I watched it until like obviously Sunday Night Heat came on Channel 4 January 2000 I think.
And then I
just had me hooked from then. So right time, Attitude Era, kind of might not have been the best time, I guess, looking back on it, wrestling-wise, but it was awesome. It was, if you were around at the time, it was, you can appreciate it, you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. It's one of those things, some of it, when you go back and watch it now, it's a little bit, not even near the knuckle. The knuckle's gone. The knuckle's just been disintegrated. it's a little bit risque, but
I find the same with, like, ECW. Like, I remember just absolutely being obsessed when I was about 15, 16, and then I go back and try and watch it now, and I'm like, watching some cards, I'm like, it's not as good as I remember. Some of the good stuff, the great stuff's still great, but like,
yeah,
there's, try to get my son into it, but
quite a bit of filler. There's quite a bit of filler in there that, the people forget about. I mean, that's when like people are going, oh, I wish it was back in the Attitude Era days. No, I mean, some of it maybe the big stars, sure, but there was a lot of dross in between.
I found myself recently going back and watching a lot of like In Your House pay-per-views, the early In Your Houses, and there's like some awesome stuff on there, and I'm like, wow, this is good. And then I'll try and watch ECW from the same time, and it's like, yeah, I can kind of see what like Jerry the King Lawler and guys like that were saying at the time, you know. They had their stars and stuff like that, but then they had their lower card guys, and it was just like a little bit hard to watch.
Yeah. So who's your favorites then, when you properly got back into it? So you said Warzone and you mentioned like and all that kind, but who's your kind of guy?
I like The Rock, obviously. Jeff Hardy, had long hair at the time. I was like gonna dye my hair and everything, and then kind of as I kind of got more and more into wrestling, I was drawn towards like Vampiro and Raven. Loved those guys back in the day, but then I've got a weird taste in wrestler. Like I'll I'm a huge fan of like the technical, super technical stuff, like guys like Daniel Bryan, stuff like that. And then I'll go and watch like, you know, Mike Awesome, best of Mike Awesome matches, and then I'll go and watch like Nick Gage matches. You know, I just a bit of everything, really, to be honest.
I suppose that kind of sums up your kind of style. It's a little bit of you've taken a little bit of everything as you go along. There's a little bit of like a little bit of Japanese style, a little bit of European, all kind of mixed in to create this kind of, I don't know what even to call it, but I go through phases
and stuff. So I'll change up my stuff in the ring, and then I'll be like, oh man, I'm kind of in this. I'm kind of loving this stuff at the moment, so I'm going to do a lot, try and throw a little bit of this in my style and that, and I guess keeps it fresh. So.
Yeah, absolutely, and we'll go through your various gimmick moments, and you're certainly try to keep things as fresh as possible. So go from watching it then, and you mentioned collecting, and I know that you're quite a collector of wrestling in general. When it comes
a nerd,
to like,
a nerd, you can say it.
I can't judge. Look at the wall behind me. It's really.
No, I'm okay. I'm totally fine. You know, I'm totally fine with it. You know.
Oh no! If you're in wrestling fandom in general. Yeah, we're nerds. That's just what we are. And some people go one step further and actually pursue doing it instead, which is just the next level of nerddom. But, you know, it's cooler because you're actually doing it. So what got you from collecting to actually pursuing it? So I read an interview you did, and it was Mr. News that's to blame for this.
Yeah, it is actually. Well, actually, technically, no, because obviously, like, when you're a wrestling fan, you're still obsessed with it all through your kind of like your teens and your kind of adult, your early adulthood and stuff like that. You kind of go, I really want to do this. I want to be a part of it somehow, you know, like whether it's kind of like, you know, any aspect of it, whether it's like the journalism side like yourself or like, you know, taking part or even just, you know, part of shows, like doing a commentary or something like that. Just if you kind of, I don't know, if you envision yourself doing it, you kind of try and seek it out. And a friend of mine at uni, we used to go to WrestleMania. Like I used to get my uni bursary every year, and if me and my friend we used to just use our uni bursary, and we started going to WrestleMania. So we went to like 22, 23, 24 and 25, which was cool. And we used our uni bursary, and he was friends with Nathan Reynolds, I don't know if he was at SWE or W3L at the time, but me and my friend decided it was November 2007 we would decide to go on W3L and start training, and like I kind of stuck with it and he quit. But at the time I was kind of just a bit kind of, I wasn't quite ready to be, this was sort of my early 20s. I just was still in my partying and stuff like that, so I wasn't really kind of ready to kind of commit to it. So, you know, I think around about 2008 I stopped training at W3L. And then I'm friends with Alan. Like I've known Alan for a very, very long time. He used to play football at the park, which is literally like 50 yards from my house. And I think he used to stay up the street for me. I think his parents still stay up there. And like we all hung out in the pub and that. And he wasn't too long started with SWE, and he kept showing me all these videos. And he's like, oh, you should come along. And this was again late 2009. And I kind of went once in August, and I was like, all right, this is cool, but the ring was really, really old, and it was totally different to the one that I trained in W3L. It was like an old, I think it was like an old boxing ring or something. It was brutal. And then I was like, right, I'm going to try and get in a little bit better shape. And then I came back sort of November 2009. And then from then on, I just kind of stayed with it. And I debuted in March 2010 against Johnny Lyons.
So we'll rewind a little bit. So you went to four WrestleMania Zero. I was 22, 23, 24, 25. Yeah, so. And there were some amazing matches in those particular shows. I mean, one of them had my favorite match of all time, Edge versus McFoley. Being in there, you know, just casually getting to see that live. So what was it like going over to see, like, I know by this point you hadn't started training or yeah,
kind of the later ones I had done a little bit sort of training when I was going to the later ones.
So when you went to the later ones after starting to train, did you have a different like perspective or appreciation for it when you're watching it? Because beforehand you have just been watching it, you're not actually doing it yourself. And later ones you'd be going, "Oh, that guy's doing
the
this."
The later ones were. Oh, hang on, what have I done?
We've lost the video for a moment. I can still hear you.
Hang on, my phone's just. How did I get on here? There we go. I'm back.
Weird phone technology. It seems if you turn it, it all goes to pot, but you're still here.
My screen is literally like the picture is literally like my whole screen. So if I touch anything, like slightly, so the later ones, like 24, we went to it was Florida, and me and my friend managed to get because this is when TNA was free, so you could get if you queued up, you got a TNA for free. So me and my mate went down to like the Impact Zone. We went down to the Impact Zone and we stood there at like 9 o'clock in the morning, and we were standing in this queue because there's two queues. There was the VIP queue and the non-VIP queue, and we stood in the non-VIP queue. We're the only ones there, and we met these other two dudes, and they were there. I'd call your typical wrestling fan, you know. Some people know what I mean by that, but like, you know, just like they were just they looked like wrestling fans, and they just talked like wrestling fans, you know. And me and my mate thought we were like really cool and stuff like that. So we had our like fake like lanyards that we made, like of like that we had our WrestleMania fake like press pass lanyards that we made that we told people were like real. And we queued for like must have been there about like 3 hours, and then somebody came out and then they're like, "Oh, Dixie's seen that you guys have been standing here this long, so she'd like to move you into the VIP queue that's hard to say. So we moved over, and then we got these little like these ticket things, so we could go away, like go take a piss and then like get something to eat and then come back, and we wouldn't lose our spot. And it was cool. And like on the way in, like Dixie came up and spoke to us and that, and like she was really, really nice and that. She was like, "Oh, where are you guys from?" and chatting away to us. And this was the same show that Highlander
Robbie. Yeah.
Yeah, we met him outside, and this was the one where he got in trouble for being on TV and stuff. And same with like guys like Chavo and stuff were there. And my friend, like, we had a meet and greet with the WWE guys, and Chavo was one of them the next day. And my mate kept asking, "Oh, what did you think of TNA last night? What did you think of TNA last night?" Because like we knew that Chavo had been there, and he was just trying to like shut up because they've got all these like people in suits around making sure that they don't say the wrong things to the fans and stuff like that, which is pretty funny. And then a year later was Ring of Honor. Ring of Honor were doing a show in Texas, which was pretty cool. And again, we went to the ticket office right away, and the guy at the door was like, "You guys just come in. You guys can have a look around, whatever." And they were setting the ring up and everything. It was just like being like a local show, except you had like Kenta and his entourage. You had Bryan Danielson walking around. You know, you had all the Ring of Honor guys there, and like, "Yeah, you got your tickets. You can come in a little bit early and sit and watch." And like the ring was still getting set up, and stuff was still getting done, but the guy let us in, and it was weird. Because it was just like a house show to them, so. But it wasn't like as big time as it is now, or later got on. It was pretty cool.
That just sounds so surreal.
It was weird because over and, yeah. Chris Hero held the door open for me and my mate to let us in. He was just like, "Oh, you guys coming in?" And he held the door open. Me and my mate just walked in, which was again quite weird.
Especially when you'd go on to beat him years later. But we'll get into that. That's another subject.
I don't want to jump ahead. I've got a habit of jumping ahead, so I'm gonna...
that's all right. As always,
nice I have segue, but.
I have a bunch of notes in timeline order, but I always seem to just move away from it and try and find my way back. So don't worry about it. But we'll speak about that. That's definitely got big capitals, Chris Hero. So you've had that experience, which again, it's weird. I mean, even I would find that weird just going to a local show here, walking in and seeing the ring getting built, but you're just wandering by. Bryan Danielson and you've seen Kenta and like I say, Chris Hero opened the door for you.
D'Lo Brown and Jerry Lynn were on the show as well. Just
don't make me more jealous of D'Lo Brown mentioned. D'Lo. So that would have been a guy you would have seen in '99 when you were starting to watch it as well. So again, just
you do notice like the size difference between the former kind of WWE guys and like the indie guys, there is like a genuine, like the indie guys are kind of about like my size, other, my mate's size, they're kind of like normal dudes. And then you've got like, apart from obviously Chris Hero's a huge guy, but like all the WWE guys are massive. And we know that was like one of the first things we noticed. We're like, wow, he's huge compared to everyone else. Or
I had that same thought when I went to my first Hell for Lycra in Dura Center in Perth, and it was Chavo that was there. And you know, I'd always see him on TV, and he's tiny.
Yeah.
In WWE world. And then when I met him, he was like same height as me, but broad.
He could, yeah.
And muscle. And he could definitely kick my ass. And I felt so guilty that he blocked me on Twitter like months beforehand, because I was very harsh to him once. Actually, not more than once, but I was young.
I had to drive around with Tatanka in my car, and he's a big dude.
what kind of car? I'm just trying to imagine, like, because I had a Rob Terry in a Clio. At the time,
it was like a Peugeot Estate, but he kept falling asleep. So he kept, like, leaning over to where I was, and then, I just haven't kept nudging him, but he was so big that I had to really kind of go, oof, to like nudge him back across. I was like, dude, like, I'm trying to drive here.
I was imagining you were going to say something like a Corsa, because my experience with the guy, big guys in tiny cars, and it's just, I think my wife's never forgiven me for driving Rob Terry about in our Clio.
He's a big dude.
It got tested that day, the axle suspension. It did its job, but the car didn't last long afterwards. So from that point, so you made your debut in 2010, you said, with John Lyons, who is a character. I think that's the best way I can describe John Lyons. So what was it like getting your first match? Was that in front of a crowd? Do you remember where it was? And what Kirkton, was the experience like?
Kirkton Community Center. And I always remember, I was talking to Stu about this at FPWA the other day. I was like, as I remember the first match we had, and he was like, and I was like, yeah, you remember that? I think you were about my age now when I had my first match, and he's like, oh yeah, remember? And I was trying to try to wind him up, but he wasn't biting. So, but yeah, he was awesome. Definitely the right person to have my first match with. It was Kirkton Community Center, 2010. He was like, I would say he was definitely like the top guy, if not one of the top guys in the company at the time. So I mean, that was kind of like a big deal. I don't remember. I still had no idea what he was doing in the ring. Like, he literally just led me around. I made it look good. I think I hit like four moves or something. but it was cool because like the crowd were super into it. But I always remember I was wearing, only time I've ever worn a singlet, because I refuse to wear a singlet. Even I always wear a t-shirt instead of a singlet. I refuse to accept that I need a singlet. So the only time I wore a singlet, it was Mr. News's old singlet. I think I was wearing a pair of David Lowe's old boots. And I wore a t-shirt over the top of it, and I looked horrendous. And I had this, because I was doing the all night Ian Ambrose thing, this was like part, and I was trying to like make the social media thing work, but because it was like no one was doing it at the time, and it was just before Zack Ryder was doing it, and I was like, I had this Facebook Your Fears t-shirt. It was so corny. And I did this thing where I did like the forearms in the corner, and then I stepped back and I went lol.
God,
super corny and super cheesy. And that was mental. And I tried to make it work, and then everyone does social media, so the gimmick kind of went.
Well, I mean, the whole LOL thing, that seems like you're trying to, you're doing the Fortnite thing before Fortnite became a thing as well.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah. So I thought, when I was reading, again, I was reading this interview that you did with a single leg takedown, I think it was. So I was who did the interview with you. And you mentioned having horrendous gear. And I didn't realize it was a singlet. I assumed it was your pleather trousers.
No, that came later on. I had A merchandise is where I started buying all my gear. I bought a pair of tights, but I had no legs. And then I switched to bikers because I thought, oh, I can wear kick pads and bikers. And I kind of have always worn kick pads and bikers since then. Thankfully, I'm not as skinny as I was then. But and then the pleather trousers came. But that was kind of like a Chris Hero tribute, because like he had like the pleather. I remember he used to have the pleather kind of long trousers at the time. Well, he did at the time, or just before then. I think that's mid 2000s, dating myself again. And I was like, I'll wear something like that. It'd be cool. Kind of like wear the shirt and then I don't need to like, cause I don't have a body. So I was like, I can cover up with this stuff and it looks cool. But I just remember every show, at least one kid would come up to me and go, why'd you
dress like Elvis?
Cause they had like a wee flare at the bottom. So I was like,
So you did decide to go down the honky tonk man route instead then and just embrace it. You're like, nah, I don't want to do that.
I honestly think now I could totally rock that. I could totally pull that off, but no.
there's not enough pleather trousers in wrestling in general. So I mean if there's guys to bring it back then you know, you should just do it. Just go for it. But I don't think it would work with the current iteration of Ambrose. It'd be a bit weird.
I'll maybe somehow find a way to make that work sometime. I will
take on board. So you had your first. Unfortunately, my research is a little bit lax when it comes to 2010 to 2012, just because Cage Match just doesn't have the records. And
I will go on record and say you're missing the longest ever Future Division SW Future Division Championship reign. Then
I have it written down, year long Future Division title reign, because again I knew this happened, I just didn't have any records for matches to put it against. So it wasn't long then. So was this? I think you won the Heartland tournament, something like that as well. And then you became Future Division champion.
Essentially, what a lot of like, you know, a lot of companies now have their trainee title, their showcase titles and things like that. And that's essentially what that was at the time. But it looked like a shoe buckle. It looked like some sort of Amish kind of fashion accessory. It was just this big black, like solid leather thing with like a wee kind of strap that goes around the back and a big buckle on the back. And it had like, it's something you would see in like an old trophy store, you know, if you're going to get something made. But it was awesome to have, because it was like, to me at the time, it was like, I was like, holy crap, I'm like a champ, and I've had like no matches. Again, same with the Future Division title. I was like, it was a very similar design, not the fancy race car belt that it became, but
I remember that belt, yeah, because I remember seeing it and looking at it. And well, because when I started watching, this is just before the SW title came in, so it was still the undisputed belt with the stickers on it.
Yeah, so, I remember that.
That was interesting. And if I remember, the tag titles, which were still about for a little bit longer, but was it one metal and one was plastic or something like that?
It was
it was a very interesting time for belts.
There was a real one, and then there was a 50-pound replica off eBay or something.
So what was it like? I don't know if you're a belt guy, but you said you were excited to be a champ anyway. But so what was it like? We trusted to be given a belt, and were you like, yeah, I'm the champ, and we just did you wear it everywhere?
I don't think I was allowed to take either of those belts anywhere with me. They kind of stayed in the training center. It wasn't until like the newer belts came along that we kind of had the real looking belts. As we should say, we got to kind of take them home with us. But like the old style belts had to kind of stay in the training center, so I couldn't walk about with it. I could take it, you know, home, do a promo with it, and then I would like take it back to training the next day or whatever. But like the real belts, they actually stayed. Like, you know, the heavyweight title and the other future division title, would like, you could take them home with you, which is pretty cool. And you actually felt like a champ because you'd come home sitting on your bed, or whatever. My kid's dragging it along the floor or whatever, you know, jumping on it.
In the fridge, you know, all the classic stuff that you do with belts.
Yeah. That's just so passe now. Like,
So that, I'll just fast. I mean, the matches that you pointed out in this interview was like the triple threat with Martin Stallion and Johnny Lyons, I think it was. So it was, what was that first 2 years before I started watching? Was there any particular highlight matches that you're particularly proud of, or ones that you learned a lot in?
I think just in general it was a case of like learning and kind of like learning how to kind of put things together. So I'm glad there's not a lot of footage, but like we had a lot of like the more experienced and like the talent guys from like up north still working for SW at the time when I was there, and I got to work guys like Damien, who's fantastic, you know, get to learn from like Johnny Lyons. Stephen Magners was around as well, and he was awesome as like a coach. So like Because, like, it's one thing, like, learning the moves and learning, you know, being in front of a crowd and stuff, but then it's, like, you have to learn how to put it all together and make it make sense and kind of just go from just going out there and kind of going through the motions to actually, like, performing and just, like, you know, working a little bit on the fly and reacting to the crowd and kind of just going with what they're doing. And that whole early period was very much just, right, I've got my stuff. I know what I'm doing. I know what you're doing. Let's go and do it. And that was it, you know, and like the crowds were not what they became later on. They were still very kind of small crowds and that, but in those kind of intimate venues, you kind of learn to kind of, you learn when your match sucks. Cause like you're not going to, if you can't get like, you know, like 50 people excited, you're not going to get like 200 excited, you know? So. Mm-hmm.
I suppose, I mean, wrestling's really evolved where, I mean, back in 2010, it was less about stories. It was more just one shots. You had that night to get your story across and get people to be excited. Whereas now it's a bit more treated more like a business. So you have these ongoing storylines and you're able to use social media more. Even though you're trying to use it, it wasn't as a big thing when you were trying to use it as it is now, where everything can be done on social media, just literally everything except the actual wrestling bit itself. Although I'm sure that there's someone out there, Elon Musk is trying to find a way to do hologram wrestling or something like that, which...
That would be great on the body, because like...
scan in when you thought you're at your peak. I don't know, 2015 Ian Ambrose, that's who's wrestling now forever. That's the year I plucked out of my head. I'm not saying that was when I thought you were at your peak.
I can't remember anything from 2015. So,
so when I saw you, the first time I saw you, it was my first ever wrestling show, indie wrestling show. It was SWE, Hell for Lycra, 9, Gear Center Perth. And you're in the main event. You were in this, at the time, a makeshift tag team, I learned, with Sam Ross. So it wasn't actually a team at that point. You were in a cage match.
It was something.
And
the worst cage match in history, man.
You know, I enjoyed it, but this is my first show and I was just hyped on sugar and wrestling. So I was just like, yes, this is the best thing ever. But no, that cage was one of the scariest looking things ever when it had the rest of it. Was weird. It's like, no, you get these shows now that are like very small crew and they do two matches, the baddie comes out in the second match, and then in the end they have a tag team match at the end or a battle royal. It was like that because everyone from the previous matches came out to hold this cage up.
Kayfabe, man.
What was it like wrestling in that cage?
It felt like forever we were sitting backstage, and like we didn't get in the cage before. I don't think we were supposed to go out earlier, right? And cage match was supposed to go on a lot earlier in the card, right? I don't know if this was like Piper hustling us, but we all went out for lunch, like me, a few of the guys, and like all the legends were on the show. We all went out for like lunch and that because they were there over for the week and that. And so we got to kind of pick their brains in that. And Piper was like, "So you guys are putting on a cage match?" And he said to the booker at the time, he's like, you know what? I think because like Piper and that were supposed to go on last. But I think Piper maybe twigged that, you know, it takes like 45 minutes to put the cage up. The crowd are going to get bored. They're going to be tired. And by the end, they're just going to be knackered. So they went out on way before us and the card got switched up. So we ended up going on last. So the crowd had to, they'd been there for like, I don't know, like 20 hours, what it probably felt like. I don't know how it felt for you guys in the audience, but there was that big long wait to put the cage up. And by the time we'd been sitting around, we'd warmed up, stretch. Went through everything. And at the same time, you've got 8 dudes in the ring in a cage, like, who can't go anywhere, you know? So it's just a recipe for a cluster, you know, an absolute recipe for a cluster. And it was a nightmare. The cage was hard. I think Mr. News got shot into the cage and disappeared and went out the cage. I can't remember, was it elimination or how did it work?
No, I think it was just escape. Which, you know, made it worse. But it was just escape because everyone was still in the ring when, because Randy did the big elbow drop off the top of the cage, or as near as damn it to the top of the cage. And then I think it was It was Sam and wrestler we cannot name that was claiming out either side, and then you Phantom won the tag team titles.
It was actually I remember the finish. I think it was both guys had to get out of the cage. I think, I don't remember how it worked, but I remember there being people who were in the match on the outside because me and Voldemort were climbing up the cage, and the finish was we were supposed to drop off at the same time. Originally, I was supposed to like cross body off onto everybody, and he was going to sneak out the door, and it was going to be like one of those like both get out of the cage at the same time kind of finishes. He kind of sneaks out. And then we kind of go back. I think it was always meant to kind of happen with the tag titles where we think we win, leave the fans on a high, but they get the belts back through kind of heelish kind of technicalities. But that got changed for whatever reason, I think. Again, I think Piper was involved, and he goes, you guys should come off the cage at the same time. That would be better, you know, the crowd will get it or whatever. Hate Piper. So we had to come off at the same time, but he who shall not be named is, especially then, was a lot larger than me, so like gravity kind of took over, and he hit the cage a lot, he hit the ground a lot faster than I did. I had like one person catching me, and I like completely missed them and landed on the floor. So yeah, we botched the finish and I got hurt. So great memories of that. Great
memories. I need to remember, yeah.
I blame Piper for that, you know.
Yeah, I mean, again, that was my first show, so I was just hyped for all of it. I didn't even notice these bits. I knew something had gone wrong because, I mean, anyone who's seen the pictures of the cage or was there at the time is fairly certain that's not how a cage is supposed to look like, because it didn't stay up on its own, which is always a bad sign.
An artistic impression of a cage, maybe, I don't know, like a...
Yeah, well, that's a nice diplomatic
tribute to
way
of putting it. Tribute to a cage match, maybe, I don't know.
So from that point onwards, so this team with Sam Ross then, was this just kind of thrown together at last minute for the show, and then it became a thing, or did you pitch for it at all?
Well, I wasn't booked for Lycra, and he just kind of come in, and he was kind of getting a lot of momentum at the time, and me and him were like really good mates at the time. And we just used to like mess around in training and that, and we just do like we came up with the idea for the Weekend Warriors, because like, you know, a Weekend Warriors kind of like almost like a slight, I don't know, it was Pipe, was it Piper? Piper used the term a lot, but we'd heard the term used before. The old timers used it as like Weekend Warriors. They would call it for guys who weren't like full time wrestlers, like part timers, you know. Guys that weren't really kind of, you know, good enough to kind of make it full time. So we kind of called ourselves the Weekend Warriors, and we were hailed from Friday night to Monday morning, and we were just like partiers. And we kind of, Jersey Shore was big at the time as well, I think, or Geordie Shore. So we were like big on the party and then the energy drinks and everything like that. And we just did these like mad promos, and we kind of got put together, and we just kept going with it because, I don't know, it kind of worked, and the crowd were seemed into it. And we could do like all these like ridiculous spots where we like, you know, tag the ref, you know, and the ref's in the match, and one of us is on the outside, one of us the ref, and we get away with all like the fun, like stupid comedy stuff that Jim Cornette would hate, you know, all this just like stupid stuff you want to do, but like, you know, like I can't do it, you know. And it was cool, it was fun, because we had the perfect kind of foils, and I can't remember their name, Stephen Magners and You Shall Not Be Named were tag team at the time, and they were kind of like super serious heels, mm-hmm. and we kind of had them to play off, but it felt like that feud went on forever. And it was like 20 minutes of me getting powerbombed in the heat, and that was it.
Yeah, definitely a syndicate of bad guys that you were against. We eventually did get the tag titles, and then I think a month later, they just got rid of the titles. So that was it. That was the tag team run over.
They said there was just like, you know, there's no other tag teams. We're taking them off. Yeah, we're getting rid of the tag team division. So I always felt like when they brought those tag titles back that I kind of technically was the longest reigning tag team champions of all time because I never lost them. And I would have defended them myself. And I kept politicking and campaigning trying to get that to happen. At least have a handicap match or something, or get involved in the tournament for those belts when they were around, when they came back. But no, they were just like, go away, shut up.
I mean, it's like, oh, there's no tag teams. Oh, well, that's fine. That's for champions forever. Then that sounds like a you problem, not my me problem.
I am the tag team champions. I am undefeated. You know.
So after that tag team came to an end, or it kind of just went your separate ways. I think Sam kind of just stopped for whatever reason. You end up in the European Championship tournament final, which I think it was when I started coming back to Dundee regularly to see shows at the Ardler, because your opening round match was again another one we can't name. So this is fun trying to avoid saying people's names.
I thought we might run into some difficulties like that.
But we made the final though, Hell for Lycra that year, 23rd. So the next, so you went from the main event in the scariest cage match of all time. It's Roddy Piper's fault. It was the main event. To a European Championship final, which fortunately you end up losing to Rob Cage. But you had some quite cool opponents. You had Gabriel Angelfire in there as well. So what was it like? What were your thoughts on that tournament in general? Was it just another day at the office kind of thing? Or is there any particular
I don't think I appreciated it at the time. Honestly, I think, like, looking back, it was a really cool, because I was getting to work with all these guys from down England, or like Wolf Alexander, he was another good guy I worked, and he was awesome. He was English, but he was doing a Polish gimmick. I don't know why. That was just his gimmick. Gabriel Angelfire was awesome. I've worked him twice. He's just, like, you know, really great dude to work. Rob Cage in the final. I think I'd worked him before in one of the ladder matches or the pole match or something, one of the multi-man matches earlier on. And these guys were all great because they would give me experience, you know, they teach me little things in the ring that I didn't know or wasn't learning at the time. And a lot of stuff I didn't learn until I kind of started training elsewhere in other places that I didn't know. And I was like, oh, wow, I've already heard of this, but like, we don't get taught these things here and stuff like that. So that was cool. These guys coming in are really valuable for guys to learn.
I mean, because at that point, all their places you may have been. I think I noticed on Cage Match there was a match in Wales somewhere, but you also had SWA that you popped in.
The Wales, we drove. Me, Alan, Randy drove down to stay with Darren Goss, nine hours or something like that. You could probably do a talk a whole episode just on that trip and that show. It was something that show. A guy got injured and carried out on a fire door, and oh god, it was mental. But when we got paid a tenner for it, it was like, wow.
Open it in a pot just for half the petrol back, if you're lucky.
I think we got paid petrol, but like our wage was like a tenner. I was like, Jesus Christ, man.
Well, I mean, that was fairly early on. Was did you have no delusions of grandeur? You weren't thinking you're going to come in and you're going to have the big bucks. Were you quite surprised about how little reward you got for just throwing your body?
I was always under the impression the further you got away from home, the more you could kind of ask for. But we never asked, I don't think. We just kind of got what we were given, which is a lesson which you'd always up front say, this is my fee. At the time, we were still quite green. So we were like, you know, maybe I should have asked for a little bit more than that.
I mean, I don't know if it is the same now, but it seemed to be like a wee bit of a taboo subject. You don't tell other wrestlers what you get paid, but if you tell each other, then you kind of know what your value is from that point. It's like, oh, so-and-so is getting paid 100, but I should get paid that because I do the same job as well. So
I always used to get really annoyed later on in my career, and this is just me being a dick. I always felt like all these imports were coming in and getting like, or import, or guys from, like, I say imports, it's probably not the right term, but so, you know, anyone that's coming in from outside of the company is getting paid more than me, and I'm having the same match. I always used to get really pissy about that. I'd be like, oh, I'm taking the bumps. I'm doing this. This guy's getting paid more than me. I'm here every month. I should be getting more. But, like, you know, eventually it works its way out. The more experience you get, you kind of learn how to deal with it. And you kind of have to, sometimes you have to, it's a little bit of give and take sometimes, you know.
Sometimes you have to take a little bit of a cut to earn the experience, and then once you got the experience, you can take a higher cut. So yeah, it's all that kind of learning as you go.
When I was really, really kind of probably at a very better point, I would be very like, we'd get somebody coming in, I'd be like, everybody rushing over to shake their hand. I'd be sitting there going, nah, they can come shake my hand. I was here first, which is, again, a terrible attitude to have, and I don't recommend ever doing it, because you get, you know, a little bit of heat from everybody for that.
It's a terrible way to segue into the next big highlight moment that I've got here, because obviously that this won't be, we spoke about people coming in and all that kind of stuff. Your experience with Big Demo. So not related to all that, but you end up having quite a moment with Demo. So he came in, he won the title. I think it would have been the year that you had the European Championship final, possibly, and you end up beating him for the big belt. So from what I remember, you didn't know you were winning the belt at the time until it actually happened. So what were your thoughts? What was it like working with Demo and that, and winning the belt against him?
Well, Demo came in early 2012, I think, and he'd seen a few of us on the show that, and he was like, I'd really like to work with some of these guys. And he's like, oh, you know, I might consider, and this was like early, this was the SWA days, and he kind of taken a liking to some of us, the ones that ended up going down kind of out and whatnot, and the likes of myself, Sammy, a few others, and we kind of went down that way to train. We started going to, he invited us down to train and stuff like that, so we'd start training, I think 2012. And I even kind of got invited. Well, I managed to get myself on the 01 thing that they used to do regularly at the end of the year. They'd have the 01 from Japan come over and do like a tryout and stuff like that. Martin as well. He was on it the year later. And then like working with, obviously with that, it was like learning training with Demo. But we started having matches. I had one a one off match early 2012 with him. And he always seemed like super kind of like, he would always like take your ideas, and then he would kind of like make everything better, if you know what I mean, teach you like while you're in there in the ring, as well as coaching. And then I kind of slowly, I did a heel turn after Hell for Lycra. And kind of the top two, he was champion at the time, and Johnny Lyons was kind of like the top, I think the top baby face, and they were doing like a face thing. They were both kind of baby face, and they kind of needed a heel in there, I think. And they threw me in because I'd kind of done the Future Division thing. I'd done all this other stuff, and I think my promos had kind of like started to elevate me a little bit, and my character had kind of started to change a lot. That's kind of when I became the hashtag scumbag. I think in a promo for my promo for Hell for Lycra. So I got thrown into the mix, and I remember the booking meeting for the Bret Hart show. The boss had said, he was like, I was so close to putting the belt on Ambrose tonight, but I'm going to change it. I'm going to keep it on Demo. And then I was like, what? Cause I was just in the match, happy to be in this fatal four way match with, you know, with Demo, Johnny Lyons and Claymore. And I was like, and it was cool. I was sad, but like if I'd won the belt that night, I was like, holy crap. But it never happened. So they waited, and then I remember January. I did two matches with Demo in January 2014. I don't know. My brain's, I've been hitting the head too much. I think it was 2014 I won the belt.
It was definitely 2014 you won it. I don't have a note of the month, but I do have 2014.
We worked the start of January, had a match, he went over. And then I worked him again at the end of January, and we were planned. I thought, okay, this is just going to kind of, he's going to beat me again sort of thing. And he came in and we were talking that, and we, you know, planned everything out like you do. And he goes, right, leave me with the finish. Okay, I'll tell you out there. And I was like, that's a bit weird. I've never had that before. And I was like, okay, we'll work to finish and we'll do like a schmoz or something, but I'll let you know what's happening out there. Okay. And I was like, cool. Then he disappeared with Dave, and came back, planned the match, and I'm like panicking because I'm like, I don't know the finish. I don't know what I'm doing. So we got up to this point, but because Dane was such a pro, it's like me and you having a conversation now. That's what it's like being in the ring with him. You know, we can have this conversation like this, and we're talking. The crowd has no idea what we're doing or why we think we're talking trash or whatever. And then we did the finish, and I was the cause of distraction. Sammy jumps in, hits him with a belt. I hit him with the code breaker pin. He kicks out. And then from then on, I didn't know what was supposed to happen. So I hit the code breaker on him, boom, I'm covering him. And he goes, I just looked down at him and I'm hooking the leg. He's got a big leg. So I'm struggling with this. I'm like, eh. And he's like, stay on me, buddy. You're winning the title tonight. And I'm like, and you can see the video that's on, it's on YouTube. And I'm sitting there and I'm like, what? And then I'm kind of sitting there and I'm sitting there for a minute. And like, it was weird. It was like a reverse screw job, I think. It was weird because you didn't know what was happening. And then I remember getting on the outside of the ring, and then Sammy goes to me, what did you do? Like, she was mad. She thought I'd legit knocked him out or something. Proper raging. And then we get backstage and everyone's like laughing. And then half the folk are going, was that meant to happen? Was that meant to happen? Working the workers, man.
Oh, it's a classic from what I hear.
Working the workers.
But at least to give you your actual, like, natural reaction from getting it, even if it was just pure shocking and confusion. Was I meant to do this? Was I meant to win at this point? But so it was a big moment because I think I was there maybe the month before, and then I didn't go to, because it's a long way to go. It's a long way to go to a show. And I didn't go to it, and I thought, oh, it's fine. Damo will still be champ by then. I'll be all good. And then suddenly I checked Facebook or, I don't know, Bebo. No, it was still Facebook at that point.
It was Facebook.
And I saw you won. I was like, ah. Oh. And I was more disappointed that I didn't get to see it more than anything, because you were one of my favorites going down to see and seeing an Ian Ambrose match. But still, winning the big title. And at that point, it was the actual belt, not the old style.
It was a nice belt. It was a nice belt. Now it's not the same belt, and I see it, and it makes me really sad that it's not the original that they're using just now. So,
I mean, I haven't seen them in the flesh since, but it looks like a cheaper plate, just a flat plate, and not just as pretty as the Paul Martin belt was.
It's not a Paul Martin belt, so. It's not Paul Martin, but Paul Martin belts are amazing, TV quality, whatever. That was what it is, and I don't know what it is, but I mean, it still looks the same, in the graphics stuff, it looks really cool, whatever, but
yeah. But when you hold it, you know,
it's not the one that, like, it's got Roddy Piper's blood on it, or anybody else's blood that's been on it,
mm-hmm. So
not being in my fridge, so.
Okay, fair enough. That's the most important bit. So that's not being in your fridge. So when you won the belt, from that point onwards, just for curiosity's sake, when you see Damo when he was killing Dane on the TV, how many times did you tell your son that you'd beaten him?
Yeah, loads. He knows. Everybody knows. I beat him three times, actually. I beat him 3 times, so. Yeah.
And now he's skulked back to the UK just to get beaten again, I'm sure.
The last time I was in the ring with him, I messed something up and he booted me in the hamstring. I still feel it to this day. So he's got a receipt coming.
There you go. I'm not saying Alan should book it for Discovery, their 6th anniversary, but I'm not saying it at the same time. We've got a bone to pick with them. Winning the title. So now you've went from winning their student title, their tag title, their future division title, and now I don't know if the history books, I haven't looked at them for a very long time, but you must be the only guy that's won this Grand Slam of belts.
Claymore as well. He had won the old version, the old version of their student title. He'd won the tag titles, the future division title, and the world title as well. And I got to hold the race car belt later on, which was pretty cool. And technically, I was their first briefcase holder as well, which was pretty cool. So,
right, so you've pretty much done it all in SWE.
Completed it.
Complete it. You don't need to go back. So after you won the title from Big Demo, the next big match I've noted down is, I know my timeline's probably out of order because I've just had to scribble things down. You were at the debut Discovery event.
Yes.
So it was the debut one, and you're in the main event, you know, just casually in the main event with Chris Sabin, Damian, and Lewis Garvin. So in the ring with Chris Sabin, you're a Ring of Honor guy, a TNA guy. So what was it like getting in the ring with Chris Sabin?
That was really cool because, like, I'm of the generation of, like, watching TNA when it first the first boom period of, like, TNA and stuff like that, Motor City Machine Guns and stuff like that. So that was, like, really, really cool to me. And, like, he's a really nice guy as well. Again, height-wise, it's kind of what you'd expect, but, like, again, really, really big dude, like really thick, and, like, you know, looks in great shape and moves so quick. I was like, if I was that size and moved that quick, I'd be like, you know, great, but I don't move that quick, so and, like, he's just, like, really cool, really, like, really cool, was really, really sound. I just remember that match, I got hit in the head, I think it was from an enziguri from somebody, it might have been Lewis Garvin. I ran in and he clocked me, and I'd never been sparked like that before, that bad, and I was like, I think I ran in too quick or something. But I remember from then on, my legs were jelly, and the finish was, like, he was going to hit me with that inverted kind of brainbuster set out thing that he does.
Can't remember what.
No, it wasn't the one on the shoulders. It was, you kind of, like, it was like a fisherman position where he kind of crosses your legs and then you kind of scoop.
Oh, yeah, I can see it. Yeah, I can see it, but I can't think of what it's called.
I couldn't jump because my legs were completely gone, and I've watched it back, and it just looks like I'm shitting out of taking it. And I'm like, and I go backstage, and everyone's like, oh, what happened at the end there? And I was like, I can't feel my legs. I was like, I just had pure jelly legs, like, brain and muscles weren't, like, working together, and I was just like, I don't know, I regret that, man. But it was still really cool.
What was it like, because, of course, Discovery came in just like with a bang, because they were bringing in guys, No Fear, No Mercy. So that was Mike Mondo, Crime Time was coming in as well.
Yeah.
Crime Time. So it was quite a big deal. It was like a Hell for Lycra. This is their first show. So I know you said your friends with Alan. So did you have any discussions about the company being set up at all, or was it a case of, you still, do you have got a company? Are you free these dates? We'll get you some matches.
I remember early on he had an idea for it. I'm pretty sure one night after a show or in the pub or something back in the day, he was talking about it, and then he was going on about DCW. I think it was Discovery Championship Wrestling or something like that, DCW at the time, which I think Discovery is much cooler, kind of just on its own, Discovery Wrestling. But I remember in the early days, I'm sure he said something about that. And he was like, I want to go off, do our own thing. But obviously, like, you know, still work with the SW guys and stuff like that. And obviously that doesn't work out as any promotion. Like, anybody that kind of goes a branches away from and wants to do their own thing ends up, you know, cutting ties, because it's just the way the business is, the way it is. And he had all these plans and stuff. And it's really cool to see how it's grown and become over the years and stuff like that. I think I was originally meant to be in a tag team when I started out there. I think myself, Damien, and we were going to have Ian Stobie as our like our mouthpiece. I think that was the original plans, but it never really worked out. I think we were kind of still doing that Y division stuff. And then I took a break, and then I never went back. So,
well, I mean, the thought of you and Damien as a team, just the promos that could have came out of that, I would have been sold on that already, let alone having anyone else involved. But so you did that, and you're still SW champion, made some appearances of Reckless Intent. But the next bullet point I've got here is Hell for Lycra that year. I think it was that year. your main event was Stallion, Martin Stallion, and you two were the kind of guys that whenever I saw a post that was picking out two guys, underrated guys that you may have never seen, it was always yourself and Stallion were the two ones that always seemed to come up from promoters and what have you. So to have you guys in the main event, it's kind of showing SWE that these are the guys we've produced. Look at them, they're in the main event and over the belt. But there was a little bit of an extra edge to it. The special guest referee was Dennis Stamp. What was that like?
That was cool. Again, because of my age, I watched Beyond the Mat, like, I don't know how many times when I was younger. So like, I knew who Dennis Stamp was. A lot of people nowadays probably no idea who he is, but yeah, it was cool. When he came in, I think originally we were supposed to get Terry Funk for the show and he was going to ref the cage match, but instead we got Dennis. So they put him on the main event. And that's a match that, like, every year, like, me and Martin, from when we started out to then, like, maybe a four-year period, we're like, oh, one day me and you, man, we'll be able to help for, like, our main event. It'll be me and you, and it's going to happen. And we always thought it was going to be the other way around. I always thought I was going to be the babyface and he was going to be the heel. Even though I was getting pretty good reactions. I'm not supposed to, but I was getting sort of cheers and small pockets of the crowd and that were... which was cool. It kind of has that like modern kind of atmosphere. Had that modern atmosphere to it, which was cool. And when you kind of get some people cheering for the heel, some people cheering for the babyface. But it worked because like everyone was involved, and we kind of built this match up, and we kind of had callbacks. Like I kind of was like, we need to put like callbacks to everything we've done previously in our previous interactions. So like we had a dive to the outside, which I'd previously done. I think at the DDP show on him. This time he was doing it to me. We had all these other little callbacks fighting in the crowd. And we just kind of, I used to love it. And then I hated it. I went back and watched and I was like, I knew things that were going wrong and stuff. And then I went back and me and him sat down like this and we sat and watched it together. And I think he still hates it, but I absolutely love it. Now I'll go back and watch it. And Dennis Stamp, he showed up and he was a really, really nice guy. And I remember we were trying to put this thing together and we knew what we were doing, but we had to kind of tell Dennis what we were doing. And we wanted him to know where he had need to be for certain spots. And I remember Dennis, he just started telling stories and we're just like trying to like hurry him along. And Martin is just stressing out. He's storming back and forth to Kit Connor. He goes, Ambrose, tell him what he needs to do. And I was like, right, okay. And and I was like, oh, hey, we've got this and this. And we didn't think at the time, but we're asking like a dude in was he 60s or 70s to take a bump for us. which we at the time we didn't think anything of it. We thought it's just a ref bump, it's fine. But like he was absolutely on board and he took it and it was really cool. I got backstage and everyone was like, I can't believe you made Dennis Stamp take a bump. And I was like, he was loving it. He loved being in the main event. He watched most of the show as well. So he was giving everyone feedback and that. And he was a really, really nice dude. And he made you feel like you were a star, you know, like afterwards. And he made us feel like we were, you know, main event stars or whatever. I did get in trouble though, because I said the F word. But I was kind of, my idea was like, we kind of got to this emotional finish where he's like, beat me down. I gave him the finger or whatever, said the F word, and I yelled it really, really loudly. So much so that Viper, Piper Niven, Dewdrop, she was standing in the foyer and she heard it. She came up to me and she goes, did you say the F word in your match? And I was like, yeah, because I heard it all the way in the foyer. I was like, it was really that loud. And then like guys like Damo and that were like, you shouldn't have said that, you shouldn't have done that, whatever. But I watch it back now and it totally, to me, it fits the emotion. It fits the story that we were telling.
I like anyone who ever mentions Viper, just Viper. They always do the same thing. It's always, I was speaking about Viper, Piper Niven, Dewdrop. It's like, everyone's just like, delete as appropriate as you go for that one. But no, the same, same with Dennis Stamp. I went to the meet and greet beforehand and I was just, I didn't, all I knew of Dennis Stamp was Beyond the Mat. That was it. I didn't know. So I wasn't like, I was going to pay a tenner to meet him because I thought, I'm not going to appreciate this. I'm not going to get anything out of it. So I met Animal, which was an experience in itself. And then after that disappointment, went to Dennis and said hello because he was right next to him. I thought it'd be rude not just to go and then go. And I just said hello. And then he started telling me stories. And I'm like, I was just like, Des, I've not paid for this. I will stand here as long as you want. I don't mind. I'm getting stuff for free.
Imagine that, but you've just had your curtain call and he doesn't know what he's doing yet, you know?
But are you speaking about the callbacks? I absolutely forgot because I had a video on YouTube for years of the dive.
It's still there because I found it last year when I was trying to look for all my old footage and stuff. I'm pretty sure it's still there.
I think I moved it to another channel or something because just so I keep the podcast off all in one place. But yeah, I was like second, third row or something, and here's a flying Ian Ambrose just like a meter away from me, just flying.
Yeah, I always remember like Brian Danielson and Ring of Honor and stuff, guys like that doing the dive into the row, and I was like, I've got to do that on a show. And like me and Martin were put on the DDP show, and I think we were like second in the card, and I was like, screw it, let's just do some cool stuff. It looks a lot better from your angle than what it actually was, which is great because it was dark. It looks like I just fly him feet first. I didn't. I hit him with this like really pathetic kind of like clothesline half cross body thing. But it looks, because of the your angle and the light, it looks a lot better than it actually was.
And because it was so recorded.
We'll go with that version.
It was recorded on a very terrible camera for 2013.
I appreciate that camera, actually. It makes me look a lot better than it.
did you have interactions? Because that was over the Future Division Championship. Because that was when DDP gave him the new belt, the race car belt, that evening. So did you get any feedback from DDP on that show?
I didn't like him. I tried to speak to him and he was just a bit of a dick, but. Maybe he was just catching him at the wrong time, but then since then he's always rubbed me up the wrong way. And I remember he went on his podcast and buried somebody. He kind of turned he said he hurt his knee or his back, given one of our guys. It was maybe an Alan, actually, the diamond.
It was Alan who gave the diamond cutter to, yeah.
And he went on his podcast and he goes, "Oh, the kid was like super excited and he took it wrong." And I was like, I watched it. It looked fine. Everyone says he's the nicest guy in the world, and you get that generally. He was having a bad day or whatever. I don't know. I don't want to get like any heat or getting any kind of, I don't want to be on like, you know.
I think I could safely say DDP is not going to listen to my podcast, but yeah, no, you never know.
I don't get it. Cause I was just going, hey, I was wondering if I could get a little bit. He goes, yeah, I'll get you in a minute. And I was like, and then he never came back to me, and I was like, what? I was really, really polite, and I wasn't even talking to anybody, but I was like, eh. But that was that kind of, that chip on the shoulder kind of attitude, like, kind of had back then, where I was just like, you know, screw you.
No, I mean, that's the same opinion I had with Animal, because when I met him, everyone was going, oh, he's so nice, he's chatting to everyone. And then when I met him, I had two Hasbros. I had a Hawk and Animal Hasbro, but they were just out of the box because I bought them in a car boot sale. And I showed him them, and he went, oh, if you had the box, I would sign them. And then that was the end of the conversation. I thought taking them out, I would have got like a nice wee memory or something. No, he just went, oh, they're in the box, so I signed them, and then stopped speaking to me.
Right. I had two interactions with him. The first interaction was I was sitting backstage getting changed, and I can't remember who it was. It was a lassie that used to hang about, and she was kind of always in charge of. She was put in charge of like helping with like the talent and stuff. I can't remember her name. She came up to me, goes, "You need to move." And I was like, why? She's like, he needs the seat. And I was like, why should I have to move? And then everyone's going to go, just move wherever. I was like, I'm in the main event here, you know. again, I know that kind of chip on my shoulder, kind of like, you know. But I moved and that, and then I was just put me in a bad mood for like 10 minutes. And then he came up to me, and this is when I wore the jacket for the first time, the I Am God jacket. And he came up to me and he goes, "Hey man, I really like your jacket. That's like heat. That's heat. That's really cool." And then I talked to him after and it was cool. And I forgot all about the fact that he just nicked my seat.
Oh, he needed that seat to put on his fresh joggies or something. Oh, that whole show. Your match with Stallion saved that show for me, because I was so annoyed when Animal didn't even wrestle and he came out in his nice t-shirt and his joggies, and I was like,
I think John the Bomb broke his shoe or something doing the demolition device or whatever. I'm sure somebody broke their shoe I need to go back and see it, but I'm sure John, was it John the Bomb, Graham, maybe?
He definitely came out. He did the device with Animal.
His foot through his shoe or something like that, or his foot came at the bottom of his shoe or something, I remember, or something. I remember that. I remember being an absolute mess because, like, they were scheduled to have a match and he just showed up in his trackies and it's like, sup.
That was definitely, I think I was last when I went to. I didn't think I went back after that. Not for any particular reason out in that show, but other reasons. My only other memory of that match with Ian Stallion, I thought he was going to win because I spotted Raymond in the pre show meet and greets and that with a replica title that had, instead of the Scotland flag, had the England flag, which obviously was just a gift. But I was looking at it going, "Oh, that's heat. That's money if you have that as his title."
I don't know if he ever actually got to run with that title. I don't think he ever, because by the time I think he got the world title, he was doing a different gimmick. So I think he didn't suit his gimmick at the time. But that would have been amazing. He was supposed to pick the belt up then, but he was like adamant that he didn't want to go over. And then he was supposed to pick it up later on. Then he had a falling out with the boss and then came back and I dropped it to Joe Henry. So just for him to have one match and drop it to LJT, which I was annoyed about. I was like, I don't mind dropping the belt to anybody, but I was like, it would make more sense if LJT took it from me, but...
so one further thing about that match, then we'll move on, because I think that's the majority of the podcast we've spoken about, just this one match. What were your memories because I'm assuming Stallion doesn't have any, when you did the callback to him falling through the ropes and his back of his head smacked the wooden floor? Because that's the sound I remember.
I remember, because I remember I had a sweet ass drop kick. Like, I don't have drop kicks. And I hit this sweet drop kick, and there's a great picture of me kind of up in the air. David J. Wilson kind of got a picture of me, like, feet on the chest, kind of up in the air, a beautiful angle. He took the drop kick, hit the ropes, I think, and then he didn't take the bump. And then he came back, and I hit him, and he took another bump, and he fell out. So originally, he was to take the drop kick and then take the bump, but for whatever reason, he hit the ropes, came back, and I had to hit him again, and I don't know, the timing was off a little bit. But he just went, and everyone, and I was like, oh no, because I wasn't worried. Well, I was worried about him, but I was worried about what was coming next. Because like I was like, is he gonna be dead? Like I can't go, I can't do what's next. Because I was supposed to climb to the top rope and hit the double stomp while he's hanging from the apron, and I was like, there's no way I can do that. I knew he was all right because he was moving around, and Martin's like tough as nails, like. And he got mad at it, so I was like, right, okay, I checked on him. Dennis went and checked on him. Dennis thought it was part of the spot, and he was like, that was a really cool noise, you know, afterwards. It's like that was him hitting his head on the floor, man. And Martin got pissed at me because I never went to the top rope, hit the double stomp. I just kind of ran along the apron, stepped off, and was a bit more kind of gentle with it. And he got pissed at me because he's like pulling himself up, and I'm standing on the apron, and he's going to me, going, go to the top, Ambrose, go to the top. And I was like, nah, there's no way I'm doing that. Boom, because I thought he was still half out of it, but he was all right.
So. The power of the mullet, that must have what saved him that day.
Yeah.
So you mentioned you dropped the belt to Joe Hendry, and then this became the era of the winged mallard.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whose idea, and how did you find cardboard big enough to make the winged mallard?
That was just me, because I'm like... Again, I was just like, I lost the belt, and I'm like, I was like, there's no plans for me or anything like that. And I was just like, you know what, I'm gonna, I want the attention on me again. So even though I'm not champ, so I was like, what can I do? And I was like, you know what? I can make the most ridiculous sized cardboard belt ever with tin foil, and I had like boobs on the side plate, and I had my son Miles helping me paint it blue, and I put the duck. I was like, what's better than an eagle? A duck. So I was like, I mallard the wing, became the winged mallard, and the cardboard I just got from work, the big boxes, Walker's crisp multi-pack boxes that they come in, and just took two of them, and I managed to get out of one box, but yeah. And later on there was like a tag team version, and Eddie Devine had like macaroni on his, and yeah. But I was just like, hey, I want to do something silly. And I remember getting in the ring with Joe, and like nobody knew I was doing this. And we had a promo, like a kind of promo in the ring, and Joe comes up to me, and he hadn't really seen it, I don't think. And we're doing this stare off. And he's like, and we're like face to face, and he's like, don't look at me, don't look me in the eye, because you're gonna break me. You're gonna make me corpse. You're gonna make me corpse. And then he held up the belt, and then I held up the belt. We're doing the stare off, and he's got the real world title. He's looking like a star, and I'm in like my Adidas trackies, and I've got this cardboard belt looking like a total chump. But yeah, I had that for a while. I had that for a few months. Eventually, it got ripped up. But
I'm glad that Joe definitely saw the funny side, because he always comes across as such a serious wrestler.
No,
when I hear my Joe's podcast, awesome, he's an absolute goof. But yeah, it's just the thought of him just looking at you. Holding this belt up, this cardboard belt, which is ridiculous. It's arrogantly big. It's just like...
That was the point, man.
with a winged mallard. So
I keep asking Paul Martin to make me one legit, but he won't, so...
I did remember back in my youth making cardboard belts, but that was next level, the winged mallard. So at this point, you're kind of... I mean... You were getting, you said that mixed crowd of people were cheering you as well, but I think they're starting to, I don't know if they just enjoyed the goofy antics with this belt, that you stopped kind of getting booed. You're kind of getting more of a face reaction from that point. And then you take a break at that point, because I've got your next bit, it was the same year, but it was the return for the fast track. So it was injuries, or was there any particular reason you took that break?
Just needed a break. Like I think, I don't know, I'd had the title for so long, I'd been there for so long, I'd had about four or five retirements, just purely me being like, you know, pulling at Shawn Michaels, you know, lost my smile a bunch of times. This time I was like, you know what, I'm actually gonna take a break, longer than a week, because I did that before. I took a week off, came back, and I was on a Cooper show. I'd retired the week before, but this time I was like, you know, I'd take a break, you know, just kind of evaluate what I've done and stuff like that, and then come back fresh. You know, I originally wasn't planning to come back then, but I'd kind of been, you know, messaging back and forth with Braveheart at the time, and he's like, oh no, we'd really love to have you. We'd love to have you. Is there any chance you want to come back? Any chance you'll come back? And like, I'm always like, you know, supportive of them, even though I'm not there, stuff like that, you know. And I was like, you know what, I will come back. And then I was like, I don't know what we're going to do. And he goes, well, I've got a plan. And it was help for like, it was the first Carrot Hall one. And like, they had this ladder match for this briefcase. And he told me, right, what we're going to do, we'll have lights go out at the end of this ladder match. You push whoever's off the ladder. But I was supposed to wait till the lights came back on to shove the ladder, but I didn't. I shoved the ladder in the dark. The ladder, which was broken, and I appeared at the top, and then had a bit of a Jack Swagger moment, struggling to get the briefcase down, and then I pulled it down. But that was cool, and that's like one of the biggest pops I've ever heard. And I went away, baby. I went away technically a heel, so that was really, really awesome. But the thing is, it was funny because like no one knew who was winning the match, and they're all planning it backstage. And then I just kind of step up behind the corner. I'm standing in my civvies, and they're all in their gear, planning their spots. And then he who shall not be named goes, well, guys, I've got I've kind of got some news about who's going over in this match, and then I just appear like this. Just like, love guys.
I'm here. I'm not taking any bumps. So you do the rest of the work. I'll just come at the end. Don't you worry. I'll be the Brock Lesnar.
Yeah, essentially. Yeah.
So
I did hit Felix Fortune in the head with a briefcase on the way out, though. He was just like innocently like feeding up. He took a choke. I felt really bad for him because he took a choke slam on the wood. Nobody's seen it because like the camera, there was something going on in the ring. He took this nasty, the worst bump I've ever seen. Horrible. Like, oh, just straight flat back bump on the wood, choke slam. He took on the outside. Nobody's seen it. And then he's feeding up after the match and he pops his head up on the apron. I just go like skip him with the briefcase in the head as I go past.
I mean, that kind of led into your next few, but before that, the fast track wasn't to be. You're Mr. Candied. The briefcase was put up, which actually in turn ended with Stallion winning it and winning the title. So it's a weird connection that you and Stallion always seem to have from way back when, coming up through the same school and.
I had just shown up and didn't know that's what I was sort of doing. And well, I showed up. I knew I was kind of involved in a match, but like I was like, okay. And then the more I thought about it, I was like, these guys have been busting their ass for like 4 months, 5 months without me here. And like, I can't just like show up and cash this in. And, you know, here we go, back to where we were 6 months ago, 7 months ago with the belt. And I was like, well, let's just like make it mean something. So let's have this like heated rivalry over it. So we went back and forth, like me and he shall not be named. There's a point where he chucked me in his boot and I was getting kidnapped after a too hot for PG over 18 show, which was, you know, weird, getting bundled in a boot in front of punters. So there, what, everyone's outside and like I'm not literally outside the front of the venue getting thrown in this boot, and everyone's like, it's like someone off of the TV or the Attitude Era, you know, like it's weird. It was really cool though, thinking about it. But like, I get bundled in this boot and driving off down the street with me in the boot, and he's like kidnapped the briefcase. And we went back and forth. Did some cool stuff where I'd like go cash in on LJT. He would come out and he cracked me. Like, he had me against the ring post and he smacked the chair, and I got color and everything like that. And yeah, it was cool. We had this kind of back and forth feud, and then LJT was so hot at the time, so anytime I came out, we had this like, we'd have these like face-offs and stuff like that, and it was like, will he, won't he cash in, stuff like that. And then eventually it was like, all right, we're taking a briefcase off you, we're gonna scrap it and, you know, put it in a battle royal. And it gave someone else the opportunity, which was cool. Gave Martin his first like world title run as well, which was cool. So I didn't need it, you know.
Yeah, you've held the most prestigious one anyway with the Wing Mallard. You didn't need to win the heavyweight again. That little dunt with Felix Fortune, though, if I remember rightly, it eventually led into a ridiculous Falls Count Anywhere match, which involved, was it two black bags full of monster cans?
It was one. That was at the time we had a the training school. There was it's in a kind of warehouse where North Highway Street, which is like just literally right next to Tannadice. And we had these old like shelvings, guys would put their gear on it and stuff. But I every time I went to training, I'd have like a can or two of Monster Relentless at the time. And I would leave it. And the boss would be like really, really annoyed that I'd be leaving these cans everywhere. So other people would add to this wall, and it became a wall of like empty Relentless cans, like, you know, 6-7 feet. I don't know, probably taller than that, probably 8-9 feet. It was these big massive shelves, and I'd filled it with Relentless cans, and so that was kind of a throwback to that, because he's like, get rid of your Relentless cans. Every time I was in, like, you need to get rid of those cans. So eventually I saved them up, and then I bagged them up, and I brought them out in the match just as a bit of a just a bit of a dig, you know, a bit of fun.
But in amongst all that, the Scumbucks were born. Yourself, JD Wild, Mighty Fine A, Divine. Say that 10 times fast. How did the Scumbucks come about?
We're all like mates, and like those guys have been around for a little bit, and Eddie had actually Eddie had come in, like, he was one of the first people, because, like, for a while, guys were showing up dressed like me with a coat throughout, like, 2015. So, and Eddie was one of those fans. And it eventually came on to the training session. And, like, as a coach at the time, everyone's, I was coaching, and he came along, and everyone's like, oh, that guy that dresses up like you is coming along. And I was like, oh, no, he's going to be a total weirdo. And, so I was really nice to him and stuff, but then it turned out Eddie's like one of the soundest guys ever, and like we just get along, me, him, JD, we all kind of get along and have the same kind of like vibe, and we were like, me and JD, I think after, must have been a night out after a show, we're like, we should do a tag team, and then we're like, you know what, I was like, we should call ourselves the Scumbags, because I'm the hashtag Scumbag, and we're kind of, we look a little similar, we kind of have the same kind of, I don't know, like, I don't know what the word is.
Like aesthetic.
Yeah, we have the same kind of aesthetic. We're kind of Jakey's, really. a little bit. So, like, yeah, and we did it. And at the time, we eventually got a chance to do it because I had a match with JD, which I got one of my favorite matches. Because, like, I love working with guys that can do all the crazy stuff. I love being able to put that together and kind of pushing guys to kind of like do more of it, but might kind of put it together. We had this match and it was kind of, he was just coming out of, I don't know what the faction was called, but they all had the I'm a Voldemort guy t-shirts. I can't remember what they were called.
Oh God.
Destruction by Design.
That sounds right.
And he was coming out of that. So we had like this, we had this match and then we did the old classic indie handshake after the match, you know, hey, you done a kick-ass job, whatever. And we did that, and yeah, it was cool. And we just started doing these vignettes, these promos, and I was like, I've got these, and I'd started watching It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia at the time. That was like, I was like big into that at the time. So I was like, I want to do something that's like, I think that kind of the way that worked. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but has that kind of just like general, these are the worst human beings in the planet, but you love them. And I want to kind of have that same kind of vibe with the promos and that. So when we'd have like all our references, our first promo was talking about like, what do we need? You know, so we need like, you know, all these bad things from the eight, all basically all the things you would see in Dark Side of the Ring. We were like thinking that's what we needed to be a tag team. We need to be like this, you know, and we'd say all the kind of things you're not allowed to say, you know, do all these things we're not allowed to do. And like people loved it, which was cool, but the office, well, one half of the office wasn't happy with it, because I don't know why, but yeah, he wasn't happy with it because it was kept under kind of a very short leash afterwards, and it was just kind of like try to push it away and under the carpet because it's, I don't know, but we were having a blast. It was just us having a laugh, you know, basically.
Yeah, you got to do it a little bit more up in like UPW, up to my end of the world. Got to maybe explore it a little bit more. Yeah. Obviously, in a bit more of a family-friendly setting, I would say.
I do remember standing with an inflatable sheep. I don't know if you were at that show, but I'd put cocktail sausages in the inflatable. It was inside the inflatable sheep's bum, and I'm standing next to Brian Lang, the referee, and we're in the ring doing a promo, and Eddie's doing his Scott Steiner impression. And I look at Brian Lang, the referee, and I pull a cocktail sausage out the out the sheep's rear end. And I take a bite and I look at Brian, and Brian just goes, "No, I can't. And he runs backstage and he goes, he's just, because he obviously got to keep a straight face. And I'm just trying to like try to break him the entire time. But that was fun. And I came back out and I think I was fat. I became Fat Jackson and JD was Prick Jackson. And I just ate crisps the entire match. And we would do like really bad versions of like their spots. So I'd do like a really bad cartwheel into a back rake. Our Mercer driver looked really good.
I remember, I only went to the Bucky ones. I went to the Bucky shows. So I did get to see you a couple of times, which was nice. Because like I said, I'd stopped going to Dundee in like 2014, something like that. So it was nice to actually see you wrestle again, live and in person. It's like, great. It was just, yeah, it was a little bit of a throwback to way back when, which now I'm looking at it was only 2 years ago. It feels like a lot longer I stopped going down. So you had the scam box, you had your feud with Felix Fortune. So we mentioned it earlier, we teased it earlier, your match with Chris Hero. So when you found out he was coming in, did you just go, right, I want the match with him? Were you approached to have the match with him? How did it all come about?
Well, originally I was supposed to be in the four-way in Perth with Ricochet, but I had just come back and I was like, I'm not ready to be in this match. So I was like, I think someone like, you know, Scotty Riccio should have that spot. You know, that's more his style. Like me, you had LGT, Stephen Miles, Scotty Riccio, and Ricochet. I wouldn't have, I mean, maybe I would have, but like, I just wasn't there mentally. So I was like, give it someone else. And I'm looking back, I should have taken the match anyway. But then they came up to me and they're like, we're bringing Chris Hero in. And we want you to work him, and you can't turn this one down. And I was like, absolutely love to.
I wasn't gonna.
So, that was kind of like a take it, there you go, which was cool.
It was such a weird time because it seemed to be bringing in just the most random of folks. You had around about that time, you had Ricochet, and you had Chris Hero, that Cody at some point in there as well, Abyss. Jeff Cobb. It was just a very, very weird time that you're gonna go to Ardor Complex and see.
I think David maybe discovered PWG or something at the time. Maybe he started watching PWG somehow, and
he'd gotten someone's high spots login and was just going through the back catalog of shows. So the match itself. So what was it like? So last time you would have seen Chris Hero in person, he was holding the door open for you.
Yeah,
very nice of him.
And this time he was carrying my bags, you know.
Working his way up.
Young boy. He was awesome. He was really, really cool. I wish I'd maybe when you're working a guy like an import or like a fly in or whatever you want, like a big name, you tend to be like super overly respectful. Because I always remember going back to when Martin Stallion tried to call stuff to Colt Cabana, and Colt Cabana went off at him and was having a go at him, you know, going, oh, I think you're a vet, whatever, you tell me what to do. So I was like, right, I don't want to do that to Chris Hero. So I was like, I do this and that, and you know, and he was really cool. And then I was like, the more we start talking, whatever, the more I was like, well, I could do this and stuff. And the more he was more asking what, like, because you're kind of, the match basically hangs on what they want to do. He did suggest for the finish, he was going to do his moonsault and miss it, and then I was going to put him in the submission. And then I said to him, I said, you don't want to do it in that ring. That ring is, you will you will die. You will injure yourself. So we did some cool stuff. And then it was kind of like, I kind of, the style of matches I was kind of trying to learn how to do. But I actually got to do it with someone who's done those kind of matches, if you know what I mean. So like, the kind of the strong style, the big massive trade-offs, you know, big boot at the end to the face. And that was cool, and lots of false finishes, so, which I love. It was awesome. And it was cool to learn, and it's cool to kind of judge how hard you can hit somebody, because like I like to hit really, really hard. But then some guys don't like getting hit really hard. Some guys would just want you to like pull it as much as possible, but me and Chris Hero were just like lumping each other in the head. And yeah, it was kind of difficult though, because like he kicked me in the face to start with, and I didn't know where to go from there, because you're selling, you're like, you're supposed to build up to these things the way I'd always been taught. And he kicks me in the face, so I'm like dead. And then he picks me up, and then I'm like, and then he hits me in the back, and I'm like, ow. And he's like, come on, sell for me. And I'm like, I don't know what to do. This is the start of the match. But we got there in the end. It was cool.
Yeah, I think it's on YouTube, I'm sure, so people can go and watch it and see the match itself. But yeah, you picked up I don't know how many times Chris Hero's lost by submission, but now you've beaten Big Damo and Chris Hero. That's not a bad alumni.
I made a run of t-shirts that I sold one of. It was Backslide. It was based off the Kevin Owens shirt that was out at the time. But it was a Backslide, Ambrose Backslide, because he cut a promo at the end, and he's like, oh, remember, it was only just a backslide. And I was like, I'm going to sell some t-shirts with that on it.
I mean, I loved your merch. The one that I remember is the cigarette packet one, which is a particular favourite of that I saw. Anyway, I always came down to Dundee skint because I spent all my money kitting down, and then it would be like I'm poor. but no, you always came out with some inventive merch. Some not so, I don't know, not so fitting for the child audience, but you'd always see kids going about with the wee cigarette packet. Ambrose may be dangerous, may harm to your health or something like that.
Yeah,
and see them just maybe laugh.
I have a tendency to do stuff just to pop myself, you know. It's like I remember Laura listening to a Randy Orton interview, and he's just like, you know, I just do whatever works for me and do things just to pop myself. And I was like, that's kind of like me. So you know what? Screw it. I'm gonna kind of make myself happy and make children walk around with cigarette packets on their t-shirts just to pop myself. You know, Mom, can I get the new Ambrose t-shirt? yeah, sure. There you go. There's £15. Boom. Come back. Cigarette pack on their shirt.
who's harming really?
Yeah, I know. Like, I remember I got in trouble for drawing mustaches on kids at shows when I was like.
That's possible.
One kid came up to me and goes, can you draw glasses on me? So all these kids are going about with like Sharpie glasses and Harry Potter scars, and then the boss comes up to me and goes, why has my kid got Sharpie on his face? And I was like, oh, I didn't realize it was one of Dave's kids had come along as well, and I'd drawn on his kid's face with a Sharpie, and I thought it was fun. I thought it was like, you know, like you got face painting booth. Well, I was signing autographs, and I just drew on their faces with Sharpie because they asked me to. So,
and then they go to school on Monday still with a little bit of black on their face from the Sharpie pen.
I don't think the parents were too happy having to scrub their kids that night.
But it's still a cool story. And then they're going to go, I went to the wrestling and the wrestler drew on my face. It was amazing. It was the best day ever. So you know, like I say, it's the only person that's harming here is the parent having to scrub it off the face. Kids are fine. They've already bought the t-shirt. Don't worry about it. So yeah,
I'm trying to bring in experience, you know, like so
after Chris Hero, I think that was the feud with Felix Fortune after that, which we've kind of touched upon, and then you end up back in the future division side of things, and you got the race car belt at that point.
Yeah, the design of the race car belt actually came from a promo I did January 2012. I got this idea. It's up on YouTube somewhere. I think it's on the SW YouTube. And I was like, I was going on about trying to get back in the hunt for the future division, and I pulled my keys out of the pocket, and I said, I've got the keys to the DeLorean, or whatever, something like that. And then He or She'll Not Be Named was like, that's brilliant. I'm going to one day get you a custom future division belt with the DeLorean on it. And I've never seen Back to the Future, so I just put the reference in because it sounded cool, and I don't kind of know what it is, so.
That's fine. I don't think I've ever met anyone that hasn't seen Back to the Future, so I'm just
I might have done once or twice when I was younger, but I don't honestly can't say I've sat down and watched it. So
that's fine.
It was cool, and it created a belt, so like which was cool. So
there you go. Yeah, it was one of my favorite. I mean, you can say a lot of things about the company, but their belts always looked amazing, and that belt particularly was one of my favorites to see.
I think a lot of credit of that goes down to Paul. Who knows what he's doing? So, if I was in charge of belts, everyone would be going around with Walker's crisp boxes over their shoulders, you know. So,
let's save those pennies. Got to keep some pennies for everything else. So you're back in the future division hunt, and then you end up in a feud. I mean, I'm skipping a year here, but you end up in a feud with Alex Webb, and he said himself it's probably one of his favorite feuds that they had when he was at SWE. Did you kind of notice how he was getting on and wanted to take him under your wing, or were you just put together and there's some chemistry?
I sort of came back in 2015 after my wee break or whatever, I wanted to just like, obviously I've done the main event thing, I've done all this. I wanted to kind of just like work with the because we had a lot of younger talent coming in and stuff like that. And I was a coach, and there was other great coaches there, like I think the Jackal was a coach there as well at the time. And like I had my own kind of my kind of tribe on a Wednesday, and we called ourselves Wednext Tea. And I would be teaching like the advanced class. So I'd be doing a lot of the drills and like a lot of the more kind of advanced stuff. And not just like taking a back bump for 4 hours, you know. And I would kind of select people that I thought from the other class were like had something, or guys that just like got it really quick, or guys that worked really hard. So you didn't have to necessarily have it to get in my class, but it was kind of like the Illuminati of SWE. It was kind of like, you know, special, special kind of crew. And he'd come in, him and guys just come back for them. I can't remember what his gimmick is now. Sammy Rikers or something, I think.
Okay, right? Yeah. Right.
Those two came around about the same time, and they were both super, super talented. Like, just right away, you could tell they got it. I had them in my class, and Felix Fortune was in my class. And he was at every single session. So I was like, you know what? Like, he was originally going to get... He was I think, I can't remember if he'd had a match, or he was going to get sent back to... commentary or ring announcing because they didn't think he was getting it. But like, I had seen him doing these promos and training and stuff like that. I know I'm going back here, but like, I was like, give me a feud with him, I'll get him over, we'll make it work, I'll teach him as we go along, sort of thing. And I think it worked out. And the same thing kind of like, we had Alex Webb at the time. He was kind of like probably like the guy I hadn't worked with, the guy I wanted to work with, because his like character and promos and stuff, he just had something, you know. He's like a successful YouTuber, so you know, he's got something. And I was like, I could do something with that, because I like playing off guys with that, you know, can talk, and guys that can like, you know, have a bit of something to them, like in the charisma department, you know. And I think it worked really, really well. And like his understanding, he's like obviously younger, so he's got more kind of modern outlook on wrestling and stuff like that. And I'm like a huge, like, I still watch the modern stuff. Like, I'm not one of these guys that only watches the old stuff. So, like, I'm a huge, I've had all this cool stuff, and I'm thinking, right, I know what he does, I know what I do, and I know what I want to do. So we're like, we wanted to put these kind of matches together. But with him, it was really good, because we would put on these fine, intricate details in the matches and stuff like that, and he would get it, and it wouldn't be like, oh, we missed that. It was like, he would get it and we would do it. And like, if I forgot something, he would do it and he would like remind me whatever and stuff like that. And he was really, really good to work with. Obviously he's kind of gone on to better. I think I watch like Sam and Stephen Mills now, and they're a lot better than they were back when they were at SWE and stuff like that. But it was good. It was good work with him. I really enjoyed working with him. In our match at Hell for Lycra, I called spots in PS4 controls. So like when we would do an OMG, I don't know if you played any of the 2K games. I would grab him and I'd go R1 triangle and I'd put his head against the ring post and then go for the OMG moment and stuff like that. And he was just getting really annoyed. It was fun.
Must be part of him just buzzing though, because he is a big video game nerd. As his YouTube channel, yeah. His very successful YouTube channel has proven.
I disagree with a lot of what he says, but we'll. I get on him about it, but
some of the stuff I have watched recently, it's Spider-Man opinion. I love Spider-Man, but some of his Spider-Man opinions are a bit skewed for my liking. But you know, it's a whole other story. So you kind of started winding. I don't know where the timeline is where you kind of stopped at SWE, but at some point in all of this. Fair City Wrestling started, and you started wrestling there. They've only had 3 shows as of recording, so you had a couple of matches there. But when did they decide to start training FPWA?
My mate, like I work with Nate Stevenson, like we worked together, and he'd been training at SWE, and he'd gone down. Because it just opened up and he went down, and I was like, he was saying to me, he goes, I was like, you should go down there because it's close and like, you know, it's a different, and like Andy's, you'll learn a lot from Andy, be good. And he went down there and he was absolutely loving it, and he was telling me all the stuff they were doing and all these people they were getting in and stuff, and like how good a coach Andy was. And I'd only met Andy once, and I'd seen him, he'd done bits and bobs and stuff like that, and he's doing phenomenal now. And I was like, okay, that sounds interesting. And then Kerr, John Kerr. I can't remember his gimmick name.
I think it's John Kerr. I think that's what his gimmick name is.
He went down and he'd had his last show end of 2019, the show me and Jake, I can't remember his gimmick name.
I know it's escaped me now.
Yeah, we'd had the light tubes and everything, thumbtacks match, and that was Kerr's last show. So I was speaking to Kerr after, and I was like, "You going down?" And he's like, "Yeah, Nate's like keeps going on about stuff." And he went down, and then like lockdown happened, and I'd kind of just 2019 got like super frustrated. Me and Martin and two others we'd had a four way for Martin's retirement match. I think it was Chris Slam and Ewan G. Mackey. And Martin had been retired, and Dave thought that I had retired too. And at the time, SW had this booking committee, and there was different guys. And I just assumed, all right, cool, I'll just show up, wherever. I'll message, find out what I'm doing. And for the first time ever, he's like, oh, I've got nothing for you. You need to ask one of the other guys, one of their bookers. I just kept getting fobbed off and fobbed off and fobbed off. And I was like, you know, what's going on here? And then I heard different reasons as to why, like, I wasn't going to get used. Nothing official. I'd never had it. And I was told, oh, no, it's just we were just having a wee break. And then I'd watched a Facebook Live video where he was saying that, like, you know, old guy, he referred to me as an old guy, as long with, he goes, oh, guys like myself and Martin and Ambrose, you know, we're not going to be doing this much longer. And I was like, excuse me? there was a lot of that. And obviously we like sort of reconciled, and I worked the only show of 2020 there. But I was like, I need a fresh start. I need a change. So like Karen and Nate had been saying great things about FPWA, and I went down there myself, and absolutely the best training school I've ever been to. And like, I've been doing this
10 years now.
Yeah, on shows, 11 years training since 2007. And it was definitely, I can say it's the best kind of environment, atmosphere. Everyone's just like so positive, and what I'm learning stuff. It's cool because like I used to go to Source and I learned stuff, but here I feel like I'm learning stuff, but being able to put it in practice, and I'm learning things that I may have taught myself, and but I'm learning how to do them, why I do them, stuff in a certain way, and like we're learning things that obviously Andy's picking up at NXT, VCs and stuff like that. So learning so much, and it's just phenomenal. It's awesome, and I'm glad I did.
Was there anything when you went in, and considering the folk that you were training with, some came from W3L, so we've trained for a little bit, and some come from SWE as well, so they've trained a little bit, but you're there wrestling for over 10 years, and it was, did you have to unlearn quite a lot to learn how to do it, not properly, but at least do it a different way? Just
things here and there. I do have my bad habits. I do, I think for years kind of at SWA, when I was a coach, kind of just couldn't bother doing anything. There was like times in training I had to be there, and it was like an obligation, but I didn't want to be there. And I was like coaching, and I felt really bad for the guys, because like I would give them as much as I could, but at the same time, it was just doing nothing for me. And I always remember back to a conversation I had with Damo. It was right when he started getting all his bookings down like south, and that when he all of a sudden his career kind of took off, and he's like, you know what, you need to remember like why you're doing this, and you need to focus on yourself. I was just always saying, and I was like, this is frustrating. I never focus on myself, and when I get to shows and everyone's looking a bit crap and not in the shape I want to be in and stuff like this, you need to focus on yourself. And I thought back to that, and I thought back to when I was really, really enjoying what I was doing in wrestling. And that was when I was a trainee. So I was like, right, I'm going to go FPW, start, be a trainee. I'm no better than anyone else. Yeah, I've got experience. Yeah, sometimes I'll do some extra little flashy things when we're doing change, just because I want to. and just like I'll do all these extra things just to practice and stuff like that. But the Gandhi doesn't mind me kind of, you know, doing things like that and stuff. But at the end of the day, I'm happy to just get in there, be a trainee, and try and keep up with the younger guys, which is hard because they're all in really good shape. But it's kind of that, I don't know, trying to get that motivation. That trainee motivation is there again, which is awesome at Spark, which I love.
And when you see where his trainees are going, ones with experience like your Omar Mohammeds and your Talon Juniors, and they're making regular appearances on an ICW, on the WWE Network, and it's a, not that it's a fast track of any description, but at least it gives you the right eyes are looking at FPWA to give you these opportunities. And one thing that you've always had is like the gift of the gab kind of thing. You've been able to do all these promos and been able to like market your character well, and through things like the infamous with the skulls and the slightly unsettling promos to watch. Yeah. But so it kind of does Andy's letting you kind of do all that, but he's also teaching you the right way, but the way that people will look for if you're looking to use that motivation to go to NXT or anything like that.
Yeah, I mean, essentially we're learning from, you know, someone who's learning from the source, if you know what I mean, like the, you know, NXT UK. And Andy's obviously got experience. Well, I've got Johnny Lyons there as well. He's, you know, he's got so many years experience working the friends and family circuit, you know, like WrestleZone, you know, SWE all over. He's wrestled all these places. So he can kind of give us advice on how to work these kind of shows and how what fans are looking for, if you know what I mean. And it's great. So we're kind of almost like learning to wrestle for TV rather than just learn to wrestle, if you know what I mean, which is cool.
And because you've got that experience as well and you're picking up these little bits, you can do things like the FCW Training Academy, where you can pass on this knowledge to them. Along with any bits that you've picked up along the way.
I popped in a few times there. It's really, really good. Those guys have got there and stuff like that. I've been along. I just went along a few times just to be a trainee and just, you know, get stuck in, try and get, you know, just because I'm really enjoying it, you know. I don't want to be one of these old timers that comes along and stands and just like, you know. I did that for many, many years, and I'm just like, you know, I just want to get back in, stuck in again, sort of thing.
So you kind of reunited this passion you have to be a wrestler, not just to be a guy there.
I forgot how awesome it is going to my work and having bruises all over myself and having to explain that.
So I mean, that kind of takes us up to date with the wrestling stuff, and I know that we're fast approaching 2 hours of chat here. So I'm gonna just do another couple of bits and pieces, and then we can both go. Just, well, I'm going to go to sleep. You said you're working later, so that's a whole different thing. But I've got my two stupid questions. We'll get them out of the way. What's your favorite dinosaur?
I referenced this in a promo, actually. I don't know if you've seen that promo.
If you tagged me, I probably have, and I've forgotten what you said.
I said the asteroid that wiped them all out.
Oh, that's a great answer. No, that's a yeah. I like them as tenuous as possible. So that's
perfect. Yeah. No, I watch when I can. I get a chance and watch the podcast, and I'm like, because I keep tagging you and stuff on Twitter and stuff like that, just to kind of just poke the bear. So
I mean, because your promos are that unsettling.
I can't remember which promo was, but I referenced it in a promo, I'm pretty sure.
Because you kept tagging me in it and you were giving these like creepy promos, I'm like, does Ian like me? Is he just doing this to just like unsettle me entirely? And then eventually I was like, because I could potentially, I might not be recording for a couple of weeks, like after this week. So I was like, nah, screw it. I'm just going to message him. We'll just see. If he ignores me, I'll know then. He doesn't like me. And here we are. It's 2 hours later, and we're still chatting. So that's always a good
sign. No, I don't follow people I don't like. So if I don't follow you, I probably don't like you. So, and if you follow me and I don't follow you back, then I don't know who you are, so.
That's fair. And the other question we ask everyone then is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
The carnivore.
I mean, I was trying to think which one was the carnivore, and then you confused me there. So that was, I don't know. So, okay, fair enough. That's a different answer from what we've been given in the past. But, you know, again, that's the question. For anyone listening that want to ask me any follow-up questions, I'm not going to give you anything. It's two sheep versus one cow. I don't care what your answer is from that point. You just need to give it to me. And Ian's went for the carnivore. There we go. So outside of wrestling, oh, before we finish the wrestling bit, how pissed were you when Dean Ambrose debuted?
Yeah, man, I was like, well, I was a huge fan of John Moxley before he was in WWE. Like, I loved his promos. Like, some of my stuff early on was very kind of inspired by like what he was doing. His just cadence and stuff like that really kind of stuck out to me, and I was like, oh, he's signed to FCW, Florida Championship Wrestling, and I was like, my mate goes to me, oh, have you seen what John Moxley's gonna be called? And I was like, what do you mean? He goes, Dean Ambrose. And I was like man. And I'd been on shows for like what, a year, maybe a year and a half, so like I've always had the question, are you just a big, either people either A, think I'm a big like Dean Ambrose fan, or you know, like, or I'm related to him. So like, so I tell kids at shows that I am related to him. It's not really a good look because I've got this mug my son gave me years ago, so but yeah, no, I love watching stuff now, man. And it's cool that he's gone back to Moxley, so I get my name back. And I think someone should book a match, me and him, with the name on the pole, kind of, or something. I don't know.
And you know, inevitably, before he comes back and gets inducted into the Hall of Fame as Dean Ambrose, you'll just keep your name as long as you can.
Name tag on a pole match. Hi, my name is, and on a pole, you know.
Yeah, well, why not? I'm sure there's plenty of companies that, I mean, I'm sure when you said when Mox was signed for FCW, John's probably just listening going, wait, what? What have we done? Who did? What? When? And then there's your match right there.
It would have to be a death match, but with a name tag and a pole. So we're killing each other and there's this name tag hanging, you know, we're like covered in blood and, you know, sticking sharp objects in each other, you know, just for for the name.
Get the weed whacker out and all that jazz. So moving away from wrestling then, we've asked my silly questions. You're an avid collector of wrestling figures, still kind of wrestling related, avid collector of wrestling figures and also comics as well. So yes. Was this just like a childhood thing that you've, now that you've got disposable income, you can go, I'm just going to get everything I want?
Honestly, I don't know if it was like my midlife crisis, because I probably only lived to about 60. So when I had about 30, I just suddenly got into it. I don't know if I can't remember. I watched a couple of movies of the MCU and stuff like that. I'd seen Batman. Batman's, you know, everyone loves Batman. But I was like, I started to get super into it and I started watching the MCU. And one day I went out, because of my disposable income, I went out and bought like everything on DVD, like right up to the latest stuff. And I watched it, and then I was watching a couple of movies and I was like, wait, there's kind of something going on here. And then I realized, I Googled it and I was like, oh, I need to watch these in order. And then it totally made sense. And I was like, so yeah. And now I've got like a ton of comics and just ton of, I literally, about a month ago, me and my son both started collecting Marvel Legends figures. So that's where my money's going right now. I think he's got three, I've got four sitting there now. But yeah.
I keep buying them up because my wife's a humongous fan of Sebastian Stan for reasons that I don't know why.
The new Winter Soldier on pre-order. This is how bad it's getting. I was watching the Hasbro Pulse Con, which is the upcoming figures and stuff that are coming out. All the stuff coming from Hasbro and Marvel Legends, and I sat and I watched it, and then I instantly went off and I pre-ordered the Sebastian Stan Winter Soldier Marvel Legend, which is not coming out until April. But I'm like, take my money, because Winter Soldier is my favorite. But Winter Soldier is probably my favorite Marvel movie, I think.
Yeah, it's pretty good. That was my next question. Which one's your favorite? But you've answered it there. But no,
that's Infinity War. Infinity War purely because of the ending.
Yeah, of course. Of course it is. And if I've learned anything, of course that would be your favorite for the ending. But no, I went to see that at midnight, and that was 3 o'clock in the morning, seeing them. Am I spoiling it at this point? It's years old. But yeah, seeing them, the heroes dust out at 3 o'clock in the morning, just going, wait, what? I'm going to go home now. What's this?
I went with my son and his mom, and she tagged along, and we were watching it. And I had to sit in the car. We went to Tesco's after, and they went into the shop, and I had to sit in the car for like 10 minutes, just less. And it was mental, because like, I don't know if when you seen Endgame, if it was the same at your cinema, but everyone was standing up cheering and clapping at the end of the movie. Like, it's weird. It was like being a wrestling show. And like, I'm standing up clapping. Miles, he's standing up clapping, and his mom's sitting there going, oh my God, this is so embarrassing. And like, everyone else in the cinema is like cheering.
Someone out there, Johnny Lyons, is fuming.
Yeah.
It's caper. But thankfully nobody did that at our cinema, because I would have enjoyed what I saw, but I would be furious that folk were doing that, because like, where are we, America? Sit down.
No, it was at the end of the movie. It was end of the movie, kind of end scene credits, whatever, and everyone just stands up, starts clapping. It was, I don't know if you've seen the videos on YouTube, but like, mm-hmm. people on YouTube doing it, but that was like that, the Cineworld in Dundee. It was like, it's crazy. It was awesome.
But no, it's certainly. I mean, yeah, I love the MCU films. So that's and even though I was able to convince my parents to get me a Mjolnir as well. That was my Christmas present 1 year, a big plastic hammer. It's not even I think it's foam. I mean, it's still that's my weapon. If anyone comes into this house, that's what they're getting smacked with. And that could just be, I'll confuse them more than anything. I've also got a shield hanging downstairs. I got the America shield. Yeah, it's fun. It's.
I'm not quite at that stage yet for memory. I don't really have room for it because my wall's just like covered in. Like, I'm looking now, I've got like WWE stuff on my wall, which is probably going to get pushed to the side a little bit. And I'm getting a cabinet and everything. And, you know, I'm going to probably get, like, me and my son are going to fill a cabinet filled with our Marvel Legends. But we went shopping in Glasgow, and we were so disappointed. Well, he was. Because he's literally going for, like, he's just kind of super gotten into Spider-Man lately. Like, he's kind of watched it before, stuff like that, and seen the movies and that, but he's, like, super got into it. So he's wanting to get Sinister Six. And, like,
all right.
Their run, I don't know, a couple years ago, last year, was when all those kind of figures go, like, super, super expensive really, really quickly. So he's managed to get two. So we went to Glasgow, and they had all these, I could have spent hours. I went to Forbidden Planet for the first time, and I was like, this is amazing. I want to move in here. And he's standing there going, Dad, they don't have anything. They don't have anything I want. So we had to walk all over Glasgow, all the stores, I think, that I knew that had like action figures and stuff. And it was a wasted trip. He didn't spend any money.
That sounds familiar. I went down to Glasgow last month, and or some not long ago anyway, and I went to Forbidden Planet, and I loved it. I mean, everything I wanted was like, I want everything in here. And then unfortunately, your son was my wife going, they don't have any Winter Soldier stuff here. They don't have any Winter Soldier stuff here. And I'm like, but look at all the other stuff they have. She's like, no, there's no Winter Soldier stuff. We're going to go to the other one. Went to the other one, nothing. And it was just like, we end up wandering around, and I was able to nab like a wrestling pop or something like that. Just so it wasn't a wasted journey entirely at Forbidden Planet. But
my entire pop vinyl collection, apart from two, have all been gifts. People just buy me them, which I love, which is awesome. But like, I've only ever actively went out and bought two, and I have about, I don't know, probably got 20 there. But like, I've only ever actually went out and bought two.
But it's a nice safe bet present nowadays, because
an easy gift.
Yeah, I mean, I think bar the wrestling ones, yeah, the rest of mine have been gifts, because. Kelly always like panics that I've already got one, or if it's a wrestling one, she doesn't know who they are. She'll go to the live shows, but she doesn't care about WWE. So she's like, I don't know which ones you've got. I'll get you the Marvel ones, don't worry. But I've got a funny feeling that these Lucha ones, I think I've got a couple of those hidden somewhere in this house that I'll find in at Christmas time. But I can wholly cross my fingers because I've been told, pretty much I've been told, you can buy WWE Pops, but you're not allowed to buy anything else, any other ones. It's like, okay. And what have you got hidden in this house somewhere? There's more.
My son's just discovered the cupboard, which I hide things in for Christmas. He can reach it now, and he knows stuff goes in there, I think. So I'm going to have to move presents this year. I'm going to have to find a new hiding spot. So.
Well, thankfully, my wife's 5'4", so I just put everything at the top of stuff. anyway, so yeah, this is a whole different podcast, which we may end up doing a part two somewhere down the line, because I'm sure there's plenty of stories, and we only scratched the surface of your trip to Wales. We'll probably get into some other time. But
if you ever get Alan on again before me, ask him about Wales. I don't have to be the one that tells a story. So.
I'm sure I will get him on at some point, because we're hoping to do more Discovery stuff. So I'm sure we will, and I'll always go, oh, this is all great about your company, but what about Wales? You just tell me all about that. So yeah, before we wrap up then, for I think a 2-hour episode. Jeez, oh, we could have.
Sorry.
No, I'm absolutely cool with it, because time flew. I was looking at it going, that can't be the time already. So before we wrap up then, where can people find you on social media? Where can people see your promos and find out more about the infamous Ian Ambrose?
I am the infamous Ian Ambrose on Facebook, I think. I am the infamous IA on Twitter. My Instagram is personal just now, but I will eventually probably get a kayfabe Instagram. Just because I don't want people adding me on Instagram and being my personal face. It's hard. It's hard having my name and my gimmick name being the same thing. But I just love people chanting my name, so that's why I never changed it. So yeah, don't add me on Facebook or message me at like 4 o'clock in the morning asking if I play Xbox, because I get those messages. People randomly messaging going, "Hi Ambrose, hi Ambrose, hi." I'm like, don't. So yeah, you can follow me on my Facebook, my Instagram, and my Twitter. I have a YouTube as well. I don't know what my YouTube channel
I did to find some of them was just type in Ian Ambrose, and
I do have
up,
a channel, so. And I upload to it, everything up to that as well, and you can go all the way back and watch some. I think most of my promos are old promos are on there. I've got one or two that I had to take down because I was getting in trouble for them, but I think all the Scumbuck stuff's still up there, even though it probably maybe I don't I might get cancelled if people go back and watch some of that stuff, so I might need to take them down. But
so if you're listening to this when this goes out and you go onto Ian Ambrose's YouTube, there might not be anything there, but you know, stuff was coming. Stuff was coming. And then just before we finish off, then we have mentioned things like John Moxley and that, but if you had to pick one person to main event WrestleMania with, who would it be?
Dead or alive, or alive, or
I mean, you'd definitely win if they were dead, but we'll go with something that's possible.
I was wondering if it was like an all-time thing, or
if you've got an answer in the like for a dead person, then yeah, throw it out there. But who's something you could possibly face at WrestleMania?
Could I pick the match just because? Okay. I think purely just because it would be so different and. It would have that shock factor. I would do myself and Nick Gage in the main event of WrestleMania, in a death match. So that anytime the WrestleMania highlight package played, you'd have like Hulk Hogan, Andre the Giant, Shawn Michaels, The Rock, Stone Cold Steve Austin, Nick Gage, Ian Ambrose in a death match. You know, I think that'd be hilarious.
That's the best way to wrap up. But yeah, thanks very much for speaking to me today on the podcast. This has been, like I say, I think we've barely scratched the surface. We'll have to get a part two sometime in the future. But yeah, it was a lot of fun.